I am reading from Psalm 18, verses 1 and 2. I love you, Lord. You are my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my savior.
Together. sisters in Christ that are also facing things of cancer, sickness in the world today, in our community. But a thought that's going over my head today is that God is sovereign. You know, there's many things that's the head of my head, so I'd like to fix it. It's broken. And my kids had an attitude for a moment. There's things they're trying to do that I'm going to have to get them. And there's some things, too, that are totally out of our reach. Some things that we cannot fix as human beings. And we need a sovereign God to show up in areas of our lives. But today we're remembering those unspoken prayer requests. I'm sure there are many in this house and those worshiping online. But let me say this, that God is good. And he's given us a living hope. And we have something to hold on to. And we'll face trouble here. But we have something good to be hopeful for, to expect in the future. Are you thankful and grateful for that this morning? I have to watch the majority of Pastor Benson's going home service a few days ago. And the environment of worship was absolutely phenomenal. And they were singing about that living hope. And I didn't get to meet the man only about a couple times. And we didn't engage in a deep conversation at all, but I'm sure that his legacy will continue on, amen. And a heart for the people. Phenomenal. We're going to sing this song. One day, you'll make everything new. One day you'll bind in your womb. The former things that all pass away, amen. No more tears. Of course, it says, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that we have. I understand. Worshiping here with us in this place. We're sick to see everyone. One day you'll bind every wound. exactly what you have for us. We thank you for that living hope that we can hold on to even on this earth that will one day fade away. But God, we have a hope that will last forever, that we will spend eternity with you, God. And I pray that anyone in this service or even watching online this morning, or even at a later date, that don't carry that hope right now, God, I pray that they would just cling to it. A life totally refreshed in your presence, God. God, we pray for the addicted in our community. We pray for those who are facing anxieties and depression. We pray for those who are worrying, God, about what's to come. Help them as well as us to turn it over into your hand, Lord. Because you're sovereign. You're a good, good Father. You're sovereign. God, we trust you. And I pray for the one today that doesn't know you, Lord, that you would speak to them. That they would sense a whole presence of peace that they'd never experienced before in their life. Only you are capable of doing that, Lord. God, we worship you in this place this morning. He said, have your way. In Jesus' name.
climbed the hill and sat down with his disciples around him. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration. Jesus saw a huge crowd of people coming to look for him. Turning to Philip, he asked, "Where can we buy bread to feed all these people?" He was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. And Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them." Then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that of this huge, huge crowd?" "Tell everyone to sit down," Jesus said. So they all sat down on the grassy slopes. The men alone numbered 5,000 people. So we're looking at least possibly 15,000 to 20,000 people with women and children. Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks to God, and distributed them to the people. Afterward, he did the same with the fish, and they all ate as much as they wanted. After everyone was full, Jesus told his disciples, "Now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted or lost." So they picked up the pieces and filled 12 baskets with the scraps left by the people who had eaten from the 5 barley loaves. When the people saw him do this miraculous sign, they exclaimed, "Surely he is the prophet we have been expecting." When Jesus saw that they were ready to force him to be their king, he slipped away into the hills by himself. Now, the definition of a miracle in this portion of Scripture would simply be a sign. A sign. And it is used of miracles and wonders as signs of divine authority. What's your idea of a miracle? Well, I'm sure we could all answer that, but maybe it's a paralyzed person walking again. Someone being healed of terminal cancer. The deaf person being able to hear. The dead raised to life. A marriage being restored. A life given up as hopeless, being transformed by the power of God and given a reason to live again. All miracles of the grace and the power of God. I was thinking this week that most of us would like to see a miracle, but most of us would not want to be in a position to get one. Isn't that true? We tend to think like that. But we need to remind you that when trouble comes, it is a time for learning. It may be hard in those particular times, but these times, as believers especially, are times of growth. Dr. Charles Stanley said that adversity is not just a tool, but it is God's most effective tool for the advancement of our spiritual lives. These times are not to be seen as setbacks, but times of intense spiritual growth. I believe that we do not see many miracles anymore in our Western world because we have so many other options. Don't we? We are all self-proclaimed pulling our own selves up by our bootstraps kinds of people. And we have so many other options today. We have a wonderful medical field and technology and all of these things that we can go to that can help us. And I believe it does help us in the healing process many times. But I believe that God waits until we have no more options and we start really, truly, and sincerely calling upon him for help. We have too many options. I have too many options. We live in a day when our world is in crisis. Our own country of Canada is in a financial mess, socially as well as spiritually. The United States of America is the same. Our own little province is in a world of financial debt, and we don't know if we'll ever see ourselves out of it. So we are at a point in our history where we need a miracle. Our churches need a miracle. Our country and our provinces need a miracle. Our leaders need a miracle. Would you say amen? Amen. However, we know that when we find ourselves in the midst of trouble and adversity, and we have finally run out of options, that is when I believe God can show up and reveal himself in strength and power. When we can get before him and words fail to pray, and we get the Spirit of God that will pray for us in those particular times, that's the time that God can show himself real in a powerful way. Now here in this portion of Scripture, we have Jesus and his disciples deciding to get away from the crowds. Verse 1 tells us that they went to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, otherwise known as the Sea of Tiberias. And verse 2 continues. It says, a huge crowd, though. When they went over there, a huge crowd kept following him wherever he went. Why? Because they saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick. While this crowd was coming around the shore to try and find Jesus, Jesus climbs a hill, sits down with his disciples, and from that vantage point, he sees the crowd coming to look for him. Verse 5. And from this portion of Scripture to verse 15, I want to share some small nuggets of truth with you that I've gleaned from this miracle of the feeding of the 5,000. First of all, the first one is this, that these times were times of teaching for the disciples. Jesus always used times like this, times where he would do a miracle, or times when they were in great struggle and great problems, maybe in a storm on the sea, and he would use all of these times for teaching times. And Jesus asked Philip this question in the second part of verse 5. Turning to Philip, he asked, where can we buy bread to feed all these people? Jesus seems to be testing the faith of Philip to see if Philip really knows who's sitting next to him on the hill. If Philip really knows, but Philip shows no, doesn't grasp who he's talking to at this particular time. He doesn't even know the miraculous ability of Jesus. And verse 6 tells us that Jesus was testing Philip. I love this little scripture. Jesus was testing Philip because, well, Jesus knew what he was going to do all along. Okay? And Philip starts to get analytical. And being the type of guy that he was, I guess, and he says, even, and you can imagine his brain calculating he's using his mind as a calculator, and he's saying, we've got 5,000 men at least, and say 15,000, and that much food do we need? So he starts to calculate, and that much food do we need? And then he gives an answer. He said, even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough to feed them. Other versions of Scripture says that not even a year's wages could feed all these people. Philip is saying simply that it's impossible. It's impossible. Have you ever come to a place in your life where things are impossible from your perspective? Anybody? I have. Impossible. No way around it. Next question. Hopefully will cause us to sit up. Have you ever talked yourself out of a miracle? Have you ever rationalized, what I mean by that question is, have you ever rationalized your situation and listened to the experts and all the evidence tells you that there is no hope? And I'm not downplaying good information and the medical technology and the wonderful doctors and medical system we have, I'm not. We need that. But have you ever gathered all your information together, listened to the experts, and all the evidence tells you that there is no hope? And then, as a result, after we mull it around, our response seems to be based on human reasoning and information, and then we take the next step. And we've talked ourselves out of allowing God to be the one that has the first and the last say. Need I remind us today that we still serve a God of miracles in 2021? Do I need to say that again? If you've been away for a while, we still serve a God of miracles in 2021. Amen? Amen? God is still in the miracle working business. Need I remind you of what the writer said in the book of Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 8, that Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, I believe God is calling you today that are maybe in this building, or calling you that are watching by way of live stream today, and to move your thinking from a Philip kind of thinking and take knowledge and understand who's walking close by you. Your life changer is walking close to you. He is the one who opened the scroll of Isaiah in the synagogue that day. You remember reading it in Book of Luke, chapter 4, verses 18 to 20, and he read, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come." Maybe I'm speaking to someone today that needs to hear the words proclaimed that you can be released today if you would understand that Jesus walks beside you. Your blindness can turn to light and sight today. You may feel an oppression over your life, but God is saying that Jesus wants to set you free, and he wants you to sense the favor of God on your life today. Learn that through your struggle. Secondly, little as much when Jesus shows up. Verse 8, then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that with this huge crowd?" Andrew came to the same conclusion that Philip did. Practical guy as he went around looking for food. All he found was 5 barley loaves and 2 pickled fish. So what good is that? It's impossible. See, this boy with 5 barley loaves and 2 small salted fish, all the 4 Gospels tell this story of the feeding of the 5,000 plus, but John is the only writer who mentions that the bread is barley loaves. I thought that interesting. Commentators agree that barley was a sign of the poverty of this bread. This type of bread was only eaten by the lower class in Bible times, poor people and servants. And this little fellow, this boy, could have been a servant, had 5 pieces of barley bread, much like what today's pita bread is like. As I was reading that and listening and mulling this over in my mind, I said, I'm so glad that God is no respecter of persons, aren't you? And it seemed like that those that were in the greatest need chased after him. He's not drawn, you see, to just one class of people over the other, though. In fact, he's drawn to the needy, the sick, the marginalized, the addict, the prostitute, the rich and wealthy. Even if they don't think they need him, there are many rich and wealthy that are in desperate need of answers to life. He's drawn to the young and the old, seniors and children, single moms, the heterosexual, the homosexual, the transgender, the battered and the bruised, the hopeless and the lost. These are the ones that Jesus came to minister to. What are 5 barley loaves and 2 small salted fish going to accomplish with this big problem? You see, they're in a huge deficit. They don't have enough food. There's no Walmart, there's no Dominion, there's no Loblaws, there's no Sobeys. There's no Costco up the street. Well, what are they going to do? Well, I'll tell you, if you let Jesus get his hands on it, you'll find out. Tell everyone to sit down, Jesus said. You see, there comes a time when in our searching, we need to realize that we cannot do it on our own, and we need a higher power to take over. This higher power is not, I'm not talking about anyone that is human. I'm talking about the living God who created you, and he knows your every thought. He wants you to stop struggling, sit down and rest a while, and watch what he can do with little. Amen? You've got a little faith. You seem to be not back on your heels in your walk with God, and your faith is on an all-time low. Just sit back. Rest in the confidence that God is there, and watch what God can do. Amen? Watch what he can do. Verses 10 to 13. Tell everyone to sit down, Jesus said. small pickled fish. Two capon, we would say in different land. What are you going to do with two capon to feed 5,000 people? And they all ate as much as they wanted. And after everyone was full, listen to this. Jesus told his disciples, "Now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted." So they picked up the pieces, filled 12 baskets with the scraps left by the people who had eaten from the 5 barley loaves. I won't get any deeper into that particular portion of scripture other than to say that when Jesus tells the disciples to pick up the remaining leftovers, he doesn't want, and he says, "I don't want anything wasted." And the original rendering of that word is lost. I don't want anything lost, so that nothing is lost. And in the connotation of this in the original language is in a spiritual sense. So he's not talking necessarily about food. So Jesus is not alluding to the food that was spilled on the ground. He would use that, no doubt, to feed more hungry and poor people. But he was really speaking then of people who were spiritually lost, because ultimately, that's why Jesus came. Jesus' ministry was about saving people. Amen? So there's an underlying theme here. I don't know if the disciples probably didn't get it as usual, but this was something that the disciples needed to understand. This was all about the lost. Those who were trying to find a reason to exist and wake up in the morning. They needed hope, but they would not find it, listen to this, in miracles. And this brings me to my third point, that salvation does not come through miracles. Know that. They may be a tool, and that they are a tool that will spark or ignite a desire to know more about Jesus. But unless the word, the living word of God, is spoken and sinks deep into the soil of people's lives that are receptive and begins to take root, the Bible says we cannot be saved. We cannot be saved. Miracles will validate Jesus, his ministry. It will validate his deity, but it won't save you. You have to hear the word of God and know that you need a Savior. Miracles will cause you to talk about the wonderful thing you saw, but that's usually how deep it goes. You will need to know that you are a sinner and in need of a Savior. I didn't say you should become Pentecostal, no. But you do need to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Jesus confirmed this, and I shared this with you 2 or 3 weeks ago. The rich man and Lazarus would both die, but the rich man wanted Abraham to send Lazarus back from the dead. So that when they saw Lazarus alive from the dead, his family would repent and be saved. But Abraham said, "If you don't give heed to Moses and the prophets, they will not believe even if someone rose from the dead." Even in the remainder of this chapter, following this particular miracle, we see that the people in verses 14 and 15, they were ready to physically seize Jesus in order to make him their king. That's why Jesus went away quickly in verse 15, let me repeat it. When Jesus saw that they were ready to force him to be king, he slipped away into the hills by himself. Gary Burge, in the New Application Commentary on John, says the crowd wants to force Jesus to define his mission and work politically, to become a king who will rival the Herodians or the Romans. Jesus wants no part of such a kingship. He will not be tempted by the kingdoms of this world, like the devil tempted him in Matthew. Thus he must flee and must push his disciples out to sea in order to preserve himself and his work from the political ambitions of the crowd. You see, there is always going to be pressure to chase the physical and rationalize the things of God with some human explanation. This crowd just saw a full-fledged miracle in front of them. They partook of the bread, but didn't feel convicted enough to surrender their hearts to God. What they wanted when they saw what had happened, they wanted a physical, logical answer to their country's struggle under Roman oppression. They thought that Jesus was their answer to get the Romans out and for them to be a sovereign nation. They were so wrong, and they missed it. They missed something beautiful at that moment because their thinking was off. Later in the chapter, we see that the crowd continues the chasing. From verses 22 to the end of the chapter, and this is a fairly lengthy chapter, Jesus responds to the crowd. Verse 26, Jesus replies, I tell you the truth. You want to be with me because I fed you, not because you understood the miraculous signs. They tell him that they want to perform miracles too. In verse 29, Jesus says, this is the only work God wants from you. Believe in the one he has sent. Believe. God's desire is not that you see more miracles so that we can talk about it. God's desire is that we will believe in him. God's Son, the one who died so that we might have eternal life. Listen, folk, if you are chasing Jesus for what he can do for you, or you are looking for the next miracle to come your way, then you will not be convinced that he is the Son of God. Jesus will not give in and become captive to our every whim, desire, and passion. If he refused Satan in Matthew 4, when Matthew offered him the kingdoms of the world, and he said, get thee behind me, Satan. I'm sure that our temptations and our wants and desires, he will not be tempted by. There's only one way to come to God, and that is through Jesus Christ. And believing in the finished work of Calvary, and that he conquered death, hell, and the grave, in order to secure eternal life for us. So Jesus gets tired of the false pursuit. I'm asking the musicians to come back. Jesus gets tired of the crowd's false pursuit of him and tells them that Moses didn't give you the true bread from heaven, but my Father did. The crowd responds, well, why don't you give us that bread, Jesus? And Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. He says, whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But he says to the crowd, you haven't believed in me, even though you have seen me. And Jesus then goes on to explain what that meant, and the scripture tells us that because they couldn't understand and believe the very word that he spoke to them, many left and deserted him that day. Jesus saw people fall away. Can you imagine the Son of God walking on earth, the God-man? Many people left and deserted him, all because they were following him for the wrong reasons. They were following him for the miracles. And they were thinking, wow, this guy could be the one that can overthrow the Roman government. The wrong reasons. You know what they did? They treated him like a circus act. We'll chase him and we'll have some fun today. We'll get an emotional high today when we see this lame man heal or another miracle of feeding the crowds or all of this stuff. And we'll be, okay, we'll have something more to talk about tomorrow to somebody else. Maybe he's the one that's going to bring us freedom from the Romans. But their focus was off. You see, I'm telling you, you can understand that he is so much more than a miracle worker. You cannot have a true relationship with Jesus. Let me say this, you can be a part of any church, or you can be a part of one church, and you can still serve Jesus. All you need to do is to know that he is more than someone who is more than the God that can do something for you. He can be with you and in you, and you can have a deep, intimate relationship with him. Don't treat him like a circus act. He is not. He is so much more. Jesus looked at the 12 disciples after a bunch of them had left, and his core people, the 12 disciples, were still there, and he says, are you going to leave me too? I love the response of Simon. He says, Lord, to whom shall we go? There is no one like you. You alone have the words of eternal life. We believe, he says, we believe. This is what God is calling you to do today. If you don't know Jesus, you must believe. And it only takes a little faith. You may have all kinds of questions and even doubts, but if you would just believe in this man that we are representing today, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, he says, we believe, Lord, and we know you are the Holy One of God. Guess what? He really does have the words of eternal life. He really does. He really is the Holy One from God. You see, who else can you turn to in times of crisis? Your family and close friends are great, but they cannot give you the peace that you may be searching for. They cannot fill the emptiness within that cries out for true fulfillment in your life. I ask today, would you receive him into your heart as your Lord and Savior? The Son of God, Jesus Christ, wants to be your Savior, and he has provided a way so that you can live with him forever. And you can live this life with hope and peace each and every day. He will, he not only can, but he will fill the hunger in your soul. So believers today, don't chase after things that he can do for us, and we can fall into that. I'm guilty. Pursue a relationship with him. And then when you spend time in his presence and you're finding yourself in trouble and difficult days, talk to him. He'll be there. He will answer. For you that don't know Jesus Christ, don't chase after him because of what he can do for you either. Other than what he has done for you. He died on the cross so that you might have eternal life. That you can have a personal, intimate, close relationship with him. You can steal away into the quiet of your room or go into the woods somewhere or in your car as you're driving and you can say the name of Jesus and he's there in the midst with you. That's how close he is. I pray today that you will call upon him to be your Lord and Savior. Could we bow our heads today in the presence of God? Maybe we could stand. his diagnosis, son was cancer. Can we believe for a miracle today? We're not chasing after a God of miracles. We have a relationship with him. And the result of that, the God comes alongside of us through his Holy Spirit. We can pray and believe. Can we do that today? Praying for Paulette as we prayed earlier, that family. Powerful presence of God in that building this week as we worship and rejoice in the presence of God. There is sadness. Oh, but there's so much hope. Amen? So much hope. And knowing that we are absent from this world with God, we are present with the Lord. So if you need prayer today, as we close out our live stream, if you need prayer in this building, if you need prayer on live stream, then please let us know. We would love to pray for you throughout this week and the weeks to come. If you're here in this building and you want to come for prayer, whether you're in the bubble, they can come with you. And that we would just like to pray for you as a body. We'll give you an opportunity to do that before we leave today. He is here. Thank you.